teaching this course for the last almost 3 years, 2009, 2012. And mostly, all of you took the course in undergraduate level, chemical thermodynamics. Which book you followed? Smith Vanness. Any other book? Any other book? Smith Vanness is the very classic book, but any other book? Pardon that? YVC Rao. Okay. YVC Rao's book, you know, almost we can see some similarities. So before starting, let me have the numbers of MTechs. How many, what about the MTechs? Can you please raise the hand? Any idea? Sit down. How many of MTech students have joined? About 35. Okay. MS? Okay. 2. And PhDs? Okay. Okay. And I think all are from chemical engineering departments. Any other department is there? I don't think so. My class schedule, Monday 10 to 11, you know that. Tuesday 9 to 10, am I correct? 6 slots, Tuesday 9 to 10. Wednesday, that's a good news, Wednesday I don't take class because morning 8 o'clock, it is difficult for you to wake up. That's every year I actually feel that at least my spot you can get 1 hour extra sleep. Okay? But in lieu of that, Friday I want to take extended session. Friday 12 o'clock is my session, right? So I want to take 12 to 1:30. Okay? So that my Wednesday's thing is compensated. Any question here? 12 to 1:30. Any problems? So that you know, and you know, after that you can go for lunch. Everything is fine. But you are avoiding Wednesday and Friday. 12 to 1:30. You are finishing that 45 minutes long. So 90 minutes class will be there on Friday. Okay. So this Wednesday also there is no small class. It will be Monday, Tuesday, and Friday. So let me right now. Monday 10. Tuesday 9 and Friday is 10 to 11, 9 to 10 and 12 to 1:35. Okay. So that's my class timing. Okay. Fine. So what we are going to cover in this course and what is the difference from the thermodynamics course we have done in undergraduate. In undergraduate level, you might have done Smith Vanness, you have read YVC Rao. But the course here, what we cover, it is mostly based on estimation of property. Estimation of property. For the estimation of property, for example, you take a glass of water or empty glass has air, right? Empty glass has air. Very low pressure, you know that system will behave ideally. And you can use ideal gas principle. That means if I supply you pressure, if you know the temperature, you can get the volume. PV equals to NRP. There's one mole of gas, PV equals to R2. Right? So the pressure I am increasing. The PV equals to R2 is still valid or not? Any answer? Yes or no? Not valid. Okay. So in that case, you have to go for the real equation of state, real gas equation of state. Any ideas? What are the real equation of state? Van der Waals. Van der Waals equation of state. Van der Waals. Or at least, okay, discuss all those things and not paying Robinson, whatever the things actually are available. So you apply them and you get the property. Pressure, volume, temperature, density, and all this. If you have different mixture, gas mixture, then you have to use the mixture. So we can talk about single phase, when we talk about multi-component single phase. You may have water also. You can maintain low pressure, you can maintain high pressure, you can change the temperature, you can heat it up. Okay? If you start heating it up, what will happen? If you put a cover, it will have vapor phase and liquid phase, right? Then you have multi-phase. And if this water has different other liquid, other organic liquid, miscible, other salt particles, salts, that means it has multi-component substances. In that case, the last part will be multi-component. Multi-phase. Sometimes in the water, in the liquid phase, the substances can react with each other. In that case, we have chemical reaction. So last part will be covered as chemical reaction. Will be covered as chemical reaction. You can see your entire component is course in this beaker. Right? You have air. Heat up, you can see the change in property, or you change the pressure, you can see the volume, you can have the estimation of properties, low pressure, high pressure, you can have water, still single phase, you have multi-component system, heat it up, you have your water and vapor, and then if the things are actually reacting, you can get chemical reaction. That's it. And that's your entire syllabus. Okay? So you have got some idea what you are going to do in chemical engineering thermodynamics course. We are very much afraid of engines, right? Or something called Carnot cycle. Is anybody in the class who likes Carnot cycle very much? Any hand? No hands. Okay, I am also with you. I don't like Carnot cycle. So, when I started teaching thermodynamics course, I was preparing my class notes. I was thinking that, of course, I don't like Carnot cycle, how can I teach this course? And then I found the beautiful way of teaching thermodynamics without Carnot cycle, without engines, without diesel cycle, all those things series. We can bypass them and actually we can see thermodynamics in a different perspective. And those perspectives I'll be sharing with you in this series of lectures. So, this is a purely chemical in thermodynamics. As a chemical engineer, we need to know the property. Now I am talking in this room. If somebody wants to know the density of the air at this temperature, volume of the air, if they close the room, you can have the fixed volume, pressure of the air, whatever properties, those kind of properties we have to estimate. Okay? And for that purpose, we need to know thermodynamics. Without thermodynamics, we cannot estimate property, and that's the role of chemical engineers, right? That's the role of chemical engineers. Without the property, without that, we cannot estimate the property. Thermodynamics plays a crucial role, and that's what mechanical engineers talk about the engines. We won't talk about engines. Of course, we'll address first law of thermodynamics. We'll address second law of thermodynamics. Okay? So without engines, can you tell us what is first law of thermodynamics? What is first law of thermodynamics? Any statement from your side? Just one hand, please. Just raise a hand, raise your hand and then tell me. That's better. Otherwise, I won't be able to hear what we're talking about. Who is volunteering? Yes.
Energy?
Okay, it's not the precise thing I can understand. Any other statement? Anybody's volunteering? So that's what, when I ask you to raise the hand, you know, that's what nobody is talking. When I don't ask, so many people are talking. I don't know. That means nobody else, only one person knows thermodynamics first statement, right? Engineering, first law of thermodynamics. Nobody else knows. Okay? Yes?
Can you transfer from one form to another?
It's not clear to me. It should be transparent. You should not be giving some statement which I cannot see. Thermodynamics you have to see, you have to feel from your heart. Otherwise, you don't know. Yes.
But we can legally create a non-star, so it can be.
That has been already said.
One place to the other.
How can you prove it? How can you prove it? Okay, so I will discuss all those things only Tony about. That means this course I have framed such a way, even if you don't know any thermodynamics, we can start from the scratch. Okay, so we'll see that, you know, and I will tell that in a go with the systematic way. I'll say that you have seen in your chemical engineering courses energy balance equation, right? What is energy balance equation? As a chemical engineer, I was expecting that. Sir, energy balance equation is nothing but the presentation of first law of thermodynamics. I would have kept my mouth shut. And that's the only answer. Energy balance equation is a representation of the first law of thermodynamics. Okay? And second law is nothing but entropy balance. First law is energy balance. Second law is entropy balance. That's it. You don't have to remember anything. We don't have to mug up anything. You know that energy balance is first law of thermodynamics, entropy balance is second law of thermodynamics. So you have got some ideas, you are getting some kind of feelings of thermodynamics. Let's look at some of the formal ways to start up and then we'll proceed further. Okay, so always you have in your mind what is thermodynamics. That is always there in your mind. So the answer is thermodynamics deals with energy. Deals with energy and its transformation. Feasibility of a process. So basically, thermodynamics talks about feasibility of the process is occurring. The process is feasible or not. Okay? That means a process is feasible means what? My energy balance is satisfied or not? My entropy balance is satisfied or not. So far you don't know what is for entropy. Any idea of what is it called entropy? What is entropy? Just like layman's language, I discussed first law. You will never forget what is first law after this, because you know the energy balance. Energy balance is first law. Entropy balance is second law. Fine. But we don't know energy, we don't know what definition of entropy. What is entropy? Just one person again. Any hand, please? Yes?
Randomness in the system.
Randomness in the system. Very high level answer. Yeah. The person like his small brain. May not appreciate. Any low level answer which I can appreciate?
Free yes. Energy.
Pardon?
Free energy.
Free energy, much, much higher level. At least her answer was a bit the level you can understand. Free energy, I don't know. Do you know what is called free energy? You don't know free energy. How can you measure free energy? With some thermometer. Thermometer measure temperature. Is any meter is there you can measure free energy? We don't know. So something we're talking, we don't even feel. You have to feel what you're talking about. Otherwise, the thermodynamics should feel for. Yes, any answer? Yes, sir. What? Feasibility is entropy. Then why I am talking feasibility? Why I am not talking entropy? It's just like guess, arbitrary guess. I talk something what is called entropy. Entropy is actually the measurement of system disturbance or system performance. Let me talk in a very layman's language who does not even know physics. You are driving a car on the ECR East Coast Road. If you go or any kind of freeway, highway, your car driving is very smooth. Just hold the steering, car will go 60 km, 60, 70, 80, even 100, no problem. After that, you are reaching to a village. Roads are very bad, full of bricks, stones. Reaching 60 is impossible, or we have to put so much of things, so much of your effort to move, because there are frictions on the road. That means with the same effort what you are doing in the highway, if you put, your car will be stopped. You have to put a lot of effort to even maintain 30 km per hour. Why? Because lot of friction. That means your car system performance is going down in the village road because the friction is taking so much of energy. That is, that frictional loss is equivalent to entropy. I will give you some other example of what is called entropy. You rub the hand very slowly. Nothing you feel. You feel very pleasant. It gets heated. Why? Because system performance, system is very fast. You are trying to do something, you are trying to have the system very fast, and we'll say later on, we'll see later on, that is called irreversible process, and with that so much of friction, you are getting some kind of heat, and that's the outcome, and the entire thing is called as entropy. The entropy measures the system's performance, efficiency, and other things. So basically, if you do like this, your entire, there is not much loss from the system, but if you drop like is very fast, your system is your performance is going down because some form of irreversibility in the system will be appearing, some kind of loss will be appearing, and the entire thing is measured a quantity called entropy. So that's the problem. Now you can feel the entropy. What is entropy? Whatever you talk in talk, you have to measure. Entropy also measurable quantity. How? In terms of irreversibility. Okay, so we have got some idea. So when you talk about the feasibility of a process, that means there are two things we have learned so far: energy balance, entropy balance. When the process is occurring, when the process, you are getting the process parameter estimation, process property estimation, you are seeing that whether your energy balance and entropy balance, they are getting satisfied. Yes, they are getting satisfied. My process is feasible. It is not that energy balance is satisfied, your process is done with. Your entropy balance has to be satisfied. If it is not, then your process is not feasible. In that case, under that circumstances, if you estimate any property, that property is wrong, it is not the correct answer. Okay. So the principle of thermodynamics. There are two approaches, and these principles of course include zeroth law, first law, second law, third law, and there is something called fourth law. Have you heard about third law? Then you come to fourth law. What is third law of thermodynamics? Somebody said it. Yes. Pardon? Zero. That means what? So somebody gave the definition of entropy, talks about system's randomness. That means at the absolute zero, you cannot have irreversibility. That means at that low temperature, if you want to maintain, the entire system will be almost like a static situation. Because the system movement is there, some temperature will be going to occur. You know what? Why? Because you know that PV equals 1/3 mc square, and that c is the velocity, you know, and PV equals 10 rt. If the c is going to be 0 and t has to be absolute, that means entire system has to be static, which can be possible at the absolute temperature, and that's the prime point. Entropy is equals to 0. So entropy again talks about the system irreversibility or system dynamics. Fourth law of thermodynamics, which is discovered by Bajan, Adrian Bajan, and which is called as constructal law or constructal principle. The first time I am introducing this constructal principle, actually came from the natural phenomenon. So nature also obeys thermodynamics. If you want to look at what is constructor law, last year I published a paper in a journal called Physics of Life Reviews. physics of life with you. Three pages article, you can read it. It talks about the behavior of any system, any life system, any machine, anything, which is also governed by thermodynamics, which is termed as constructal law, constructal principle. For example, I'll tell you, when the atmospheric temperature is very low, you are not wearing a sweater. What you do with this kind of dress, if I go, I'll be doing like this. Because I feel very cold. Why I'm doing like this? Because in this way, I will create more resistive parts to minimize heat loss from the system. In this way, I will create a more resistive part to minimize the heat loss. Okay? When I feel very hot, suddenly my temperature is getting released. I want to say, okay, I am like that, and in fact, you know, we put woolen sweaters for the cold atmosphere. Why? Woolen sweaters, if you have the air layer inside, entrapped air layer, that actually acts as insulator. That means the system temperature will not go out and will be better. So, our life, we make it such a way, it is comfortable. And for the comfortable purpose, we make a path. We have a path or a system, but the transport phenomena or whatever, which will actually be such that the system will behave in a comfortable manner. And that is also governed by thermodynamics. So, any kind of machine you design, sometimes you have a fork, we have a handle here, and we actually use, or some kind of the people who are working in the house making, we have cement, you know, and we just keep it and go like this. Why the structure is like that? Why not it could be something different? It means that how our hand moves. How fast we can do the work. So that is called constructor law. So please look at my paper. There are a lot of articles. Professor Bejan is the father of constructor law. His name is in the Wikipedia. You can see that. And he was my master's advisor. So when I did my master's research in IISc Bangalore, I have two guys, one from IISc and one from University of North Carolina, US, Professor Bejan. So he was my master's advisor. And that time I was working on a system which is known as honeybee swarm. The bunch of honeybees, it is not honeybee hive, honeybee swarm. How they survive in a very cold atmosphere in North America, minus 5 degrees centigrade. And how our heat transfer model can predict the temperature profile within the honeybee swarm. And that was the basis of the constructor law. And after that, 1997 onwards, the constructor law emerged like a new principle. And it is known as the fourth law of thermodynamics, which relates heat transfer or the transport or the physics with the life. So physics with life, which is essentially the fourth law of thermodynamics. Okay. Coming back to the principle of thermodynamics, which are having two parts. One is macroscopic and what one is microscopic. So one is macroscopic, another is microscopic. So macroscopic thermodynamics, we call this as classical thermodynamics. And this microscopic approach, we call this as a statistical thermodynamics. So the classical thermodynamics and this microscopic approach is a statistical thermodynamics. Okay? So, in our syllabus, current syllabus, we'll be talking about the macroscopic properties mostly. I will, although of course, I will discuss about the difference between microscopy and macroscopic thermodynamics. So, macroscopic property, what you measure? Thermometer, you measure temperature. Okay? So, you measure temperature at a particular point in the system. Your thermometer will give the reading. What is this system? What is this particular point? This particular point, if you see the microscope, this is this point, you can see thousands of molecules. And these molecules are having random motion. These molecules are having random motion. They are moving here and there. We measure the property here, the macroscopic property. If you want to see what is going on at a particular point, movement of the molecules, there is called microscopic approach. From this microscopic approach, there are certain rules and principles we can even measure the temperature. If you, this length, this may be 0.01 millimeter, but it's you can see in terms of angstrom, in this particular angstrom unit you can see, and the particular temperature would be fluctuating like this. But here what you are seeing, the average, to macroscopic will give the average, microscopic will give the fluctuation. See, if a classical thermodynamics man will give a temperature constant value, a statistical thermodynamics man will give a temperature with this fluctuation. A statistical thermodynamics man will give you temperature fluctuation. How to measure temperature by the statistical thermodynamics? There's a concept called ensemble. Don't talk here. The basis is partition functions. I won't talk about all those, but one can, if one is really interested on that, can dig on more and get more philosophical perspective on the microscopic sense. Okay, so interaction of molecules generally we don't consider in the true sense for the microscopic approach, but macroscopic approach is very straightforward with this classical thermodynamics. For example, you can feel the variables, the temperature, you can say it's very hot, it's very cold. Pressure you can feel, we can feel the volume. So, whatever you feel, it is nothing but classical thermodynamics. In statistical thermodynamics, you cannot feel. We have to see, we have to depend on the physics of the principles. Okay. So, we have learned enough of the macroscopic and microscopic approach. Now, we will be talking about what is the difference between real system and thermodynamic system. So, we talk about thermodynamic system. And control volume. We have system. Boundary. And this is surroundings. So we have system and surroundings, and we have the boundary. Okay? So this is nothing but thermodynamic system. So thermodynamic system, when you define system, we need to have surroundings. And between system and surroundings, this is about that's a boundary. Okay? So this is called as thermodynamic system. This is called as thermodynamic system. We have system, we have boundary, we have energy in, we have energy out. This is surroundings. No mass transfer. This is the example of a closed system. So we have seen that, you can see that thermodynamic system has system and surroundings. Any closed system, open system. So what is for open system? Open system is very straightforward. System, surroundings, energy, energy out, mass in, mass out. Okay, so open system. System, surroundings, energy in, mass in, energy out, mass out. This is the, and this is the system boundary. The system boundary, and this is the example of open system. This is the example of open system. And quite often we talk about insulated system. Sometimes we talk about universe, system plus surroundings, which is called as universe. Universe is also known as isolated system. That means isolated system, as such a system, we don't have any surroundings, similar to universe. Universe consists of system and surroundings. Beyond universe, nothing is actually there. So all these things are philosophical inclusions. I am not going to discuss much on that. Now we have quite a fair idea of system. I have given a lot of varieties of system and surroundings, how they are, how the system behavior will be, what other things can occur in system. Energy transfer, mass transfer, it all occur. And since I'm discussing that, how the mass transfer plays role in thermodynamics. Heat transfer plays a role in thermodynamics, right? Because temperature changes, entropy changes. Does mass transfer play a role in thermodynamics? Any answer? Does mass transfer play a role in thermodynamics? Yes or no? Yes, how? Pardon? I can't understand. Okay. Any other? Oh, so all you are giving all philosophical answer. I can't even understand. Yeah, sit and talk. Yeah, relax. Yeah.
Latency transferred by mass.
Mass transfer, do you know the definition of mass transfer? Have you done mass transfer? Which book you follow? Travel? What is, why mass transfer occurs? Yes, I'm talking about that mass. Because what will actually happen, a duster is very much hot. I'm putting in the cold bath, temperature is getting reduced. You can say that, okay, mass transfer occurs because I'm putting the duster in the cold water. There is not a mass transfer. Right? So don't get confused. I can put anything. I am putting the duster from here to here. There is not mass transfer. Right? Okay. Mass transfer something is different. Very complicated. Generally, I am telling you, but you are correct. A layman will say, okay, I am just putting mass one from to here, there is mass transfer. But chemical engineers are always create problems for others. Chemical engineers will say, no, this is not mass transfer. Mass transfer is something different. You know the answer. So mass transfer occurs due to the constant difference. There is not a correct answer also. It can occur due to temperature difference also. So we say that due to difference in chemical potential that we'll discuss in the thermodynamics class, what is called chemical potential. So far you don't know. You may know, I don't know what is chemical potential so far. Due to temperature difference, mass transfer can occur. Due to concentration difference, mass transfer can occur. Similarly, due to concentration difference, temperature can change. Due to temperature difference, thermal gradient, temperature can change in the system. Heat transfer can occur. So heat transfer can occur due to temperature gradient and concentration gradient both. So there are, if you want to know what are those effects, please look at the two effects on Dufour effect. Another effect is called as Soré effect. Soré effect is mass transfer due to temperature difference, and Dufour effect is the heat transfer due to concentration difference. Okay. So that's what I'm saying, that okay. So coming back, so how the mass transfer plays a role in thermodynamics? What quantity is being altered? I have discussed that quantity today. Yeah, we're talking like a layman. What quantity you feel that? See, if heat transport occurs, you can see that the temperature is changing, it is being transferred, entropy is being changed. So for mass transfer, what quantity is being changed? What quantity is being altered? Pardon?
Number of moles,
that is? I don't know chemical potential, I have not discussed. I don't know, it's a very high from the stuff, chemical potential, I don't know. What is chemical potential? You may know, I don't know. Pardon? It's not thermodynamic quantity. What is that? Think about entropy. I was talking so much of entropy. Entropy is such a thing, you know, for anything entropy can change. As I told, no? The car driver is driving. There also entropy is changing, right? So with that concept, you could have given me the answer. Yes, mass transfer will change the entropy. Something is occurring. Anything occurs, and if it is very fast, some kind of irreversibility in the system, entropy will change. Entropy will come in picture. So for mass transfer, at least if there is irreversibility, we can talk about entropy. Okay. So those kind of concepts, which are very simple, remember that please do not use any jargon, any complicated things. Whatever you feel, that is the part of thermodynamics. You have to feel the thermodynamics. If you talk free energy, chemical potential, without having the feelings, you'll be lost. And I don't talk much on those. Unless I make sure that you are feeling chemical potential. What is chemical potential? You have to feel for. Otherwise, you should not talk about chemical potential. Okay, so let's talk about the system, homogeneous system, heterogeneous system. Systems of two types. Homogeneous and heterogeneous. Homogeneous system and heterogeneous system. So homogeneous system, properties are the same throughout. Properties are same throughout. Properties vary smoothly without showing any discontinuity. And what are the examples of homogeneous system? Liquid, water, and air. Homogeneous system. Or dust-free air is homogeneous system. So liquid water, dust-free air is homogeneous system. That means homogeneous system
As a layman, you can think about, if you measure a property, a system, now everywhere the properties are same, you know, I have not talked about any gradient process, in equilibrium, or anything is, everything is stable. If I see that for the whole room, forget about temperature gradient, I don't have any, but everywhere property is same, that's called homogeneous. Homogeneous system, there is no gradient, everything is same, equilibrium process. Heterogeneous is a system consists of two or more distinct homogeneous regions or phases, and there are sudden change of properties. There are sudden changes of properties. Changes of properties at the phase boundary. The phase boundary. Example of heterogeneous phase, mixture of, we have seen today, I have already discussed, mixture of benzene and water. This is multiphase example, and water and water vapor. As I talked in the very beginning, that if you, what will happen if you start eating water? Water and water vapor. So we have homogeneous and heterogeneous examples. I have talked so much on thermodynamic property. Now let's look at the formal introduction of thermodynamic property. What do you mean by property? So we have talked enough of the system. We have seen that what can happen in the system, what can occur in the system, what are the possibilities of the systems and surroundings composition format. So let's look at the property. Now look at property. When you talk about property in thermodynamics, I will only refer thermodynamic property. Property is used as such general, but since thermodynamics class, it is better to talk about thermodynamic property. For example, the variable Z is a function of x, y. Like pressure, the function of volume and temperature. Okay? So Z is a function of x, y. Similarly, like pressure is a function of volume and temperature. Okay? You want to calculate delta P, which is P V2 E2 minus P V1 E2. That means my initial point is, if you want to look at, this is your V plane, this is your T plane, this is my coordinate V1, T1, this is my coordinate V2, T1. To reach this point, I can go by any ways, like this, like this, like this, like this, or I can go like this. If I go like this, that means a particular temperature, I am changing the volume. That means if my property is Z by dou V at fixed temperature, at this point it is dou Z by dou T at fixed volume, right? This is this
part, temperature is changing, volume is fixed. Dose A by dou T at fixed V. Okay? What it says that? Dou squared Z by dou T dou V is my total change with respect to temperature and volume. Okay? It can be written as or that means we can eventually write this as this, you know, right? In mathematics, definition of double derivative, d2y by dx squared is what? Ddx of dy dx. Similarly, if you have two variables, we know the definition, right? We have done in BTech Fast Mathematics. If you can write interchanging this, dou dou v or dou z dou t, and in essential you are actually getting dou 2z dou t dou v, dou 2z equal dou v dou t. That means we have a zxy. That means what I am saying that if you take this part and come to this part, you will get a change in property, delta p. Or you can go to this part. That means first you are having dou z dou t v part, and then you go for dou z dou v v t part. If you get the same change in delta p, that p must be a property. If it is not, that is not a thermodynamic property. If it is not, that is not a thermodynamic property. That means if I give any function, I ask, is it a thermodynamic property? Somebody is giving a function, then I will say that I have to see the path, I have to evaluate this, and I have to verify if it is matching. That means either I can go by this way, or I can go by any other way. This is very complicated to write in terms of this, because you cannot write in terms, because V and D you can see that. Okay? If you can verify that this is actually working, then that is called thermodynamic property. That means thermodynamic property depends on the initial and final state, not the path. So thermodynamic property is a path-independent function. So we have learned thermodynamic property. It is a thermodynamic property which is nothing but the path independent function. Path independent, path independent function. So which is known as path independent function. I will stop here today. So next class we will start talking more on that. And thanks for your kind attention.